Hey, y'all. It's birthday week at our place. Yeah, Darla's having a birthday. Then Brayden, 3 days later, was born. So his birthday is this week. And then Blake, if you're watching, Blake was born 3 days after that. We're the family of threes now. So, you know, Brayden came along and blew up her birthday. And now Blake, out of payback, comes along and blows up Brayden's birthday. So really, we're only having one birthday this week, and the other two get a card. Like, here you go. Go get a Starbucks. Anyway, good to see you. Wow. Great crowd. Thanks for being here. And we have people outside. I went out and waved at them during worship, and I'm glad that they are watching the big screen and are engaging with us in that way. Say hello to all of you online. I'm looking forward to sharing God's word with you today. And I definitely have a word from the Lord. If you've come in and you're really going through some heavy stuff, even some unspeakable stuff on the inside, I think today's message is just going to be just what you needed. So Lord, we just focus our attention on you. I pray that my humanness would slide out of the way and that your word would just come strong to people's hearts. I pray that they'll be able to see the Spirit connecting the dots to their own experiences so that they can be encouraged and have hope and be strengthened by sitting under your word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, I love you. God bless you. And we'll get the message started. You know, we're going to talk today a little bit about the children of Israel that were stuck in a very difficult place, actually. They lost their land. They became landless. And when you get into a difficult spot, it's easy to ask why. You know, a lot of people told me after my daughter passed away, they're like, well, you never ask God why, to which my response is always, why? Because if we're in covenant with God and God loves me and I love him, then if there are some things I don't understand, I feel like it absolutely begs the question, why? But you don't want to live in the land of why. Some people get stuck living in the land of why. And if you want to relocate to a town called why, you actually would have to move to Arizona. There is a town called Arizona, called why, Arizona. It's about 91 miles east of Mexicali, Mexico, and about 150 miles west of Tucson, Arizona, in case you're wanting to go there. If you are wanting to go there, let me mention to you a great restaurant to try. Actually, it's the only restaurant. Actually, it's not even a restaurant. It's actually a pickup place. It is a Rocky Point Seafood Market there in the northern tip of the Sonoran Desert. Don't ask me how you get a seafood market in the north part of the Sonoran Desert, but nevertheless, that's there. It's just a little bit down the road from Sundown Lane, in case you're interested. Now, in the 2020 census, only 162 people lived in Y, Arizona, because I figure just living in the land of Y is like not wise, apparently. So when you get stuck in the land of Y, you only want to visit. In fact, in this place, you can't even really spend the night there because there's no hotels and motels in the land of Y, Arizona. And so I've been thinking about, there's a lot of people that are going through things that leave them stuck in the land of why. Why is this happening to me? Why? I thought my life would be different. And so I want to talk to you about, this is really what the Jewish people found themselves in, this landless place, a place they didn't belong, and they were trying to figure out how to belong. So the book of Isaiah tracks the people. The first 39 chapters of Isaiah really is talking about them being in exile and them living in disobedience. And then the second half of Isaiah talks about the restoration or the hope. And that's really what I believe today. I believe that coming out of this message that your heart's going to be strengthened and you're really going to move from a land of why or a land of confusion or in a place and live more in a place of hope. Ezekiel and Jeremiah talked a lot about exile and the restoration of God's people. And these themes emerge from it, that they told them, you will be a people that live in a lost place. You'll be a people of the lost place. Anybody ever go through something like that? Ever go through a season where you just felt lost? You can't seem to make sense of things. That happened to us when our daughter died. And, you know, here's our family pictures hanging on the wall all around. It's all framed in. It all looks great. And then Whitney dies. And it's like our whole family dynamic changed. It all changed. It was like part of the frame was broken off. And now the family, we have to do new photos. And these new photos are different and strange to us. It's not anything we ever expected. And they're quite different than what we had before. And the people here were dominated by grief over the way things used to be. But to realize we can never go back to that place, that you have to make a new home in a strange place, that's really the experience that you have in life. And I don't know that a lot of people talk about it, but life is not about being happy and growing old. That's not what life is about. Life is about surviving the hits to your faith and staying at the task of showing faith in God, even if he doesn't answer your question of why. And you see the people of God lamenting down by the river in Psalm 137, verse 1. It says, "By the rivers of Babylon, there we sat down, and there we wept when we remembered Zion." This when you see Zion, you wouldn't think of it, but for Darla and me, it brings this special memory. And probably for those that have traveled to Jerusalem, when you go to Jerusalem in the land of Israel, you come up, the road is cut through these mountains, and you come through this mountain pass on this tour bus, and your guide says, "Now, if you'll look to the left, you'll see the city of Jerusalem as you pop up." And I mean, it is breathtaking, it's emotional, it's overwhelming. You can see the Dome of the Rock, you can see all just the city sights, you can see the wall around the city, and the old city of David. It's just amazing. You see it, and brought tears to my eyes, and the tour bus we were on all cheered, and then we all got misty-eyed, and then we all kind of had these spiritual moments thinking about, well, that's what the children of Israel went through when they lost their land, when it all happened. In fact, the temple that David's son Solomon built was about 3,000 years ago. But about 2,500 years ago, Nebuchadnezzar, remember the three Hebrew children, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and Daniel, and all of that. So Nebuchadnezzar came to Jerusalem, destroyed the temple, destroyed what they knew, and then captured huge numbers of the people and took them captive back to the land of Babylon. And so the armies of the king conquered the city and destroyed it. And so I can only imagine how sentimental they were, or you know, thinking about their children are not going to grow up and see the temple Solomon had built, and trying to explain their faith in a foreign land, and all of that's going to be uncomfortable. But somehow God allowed it. God was involved in it and played some kind of role in it. And when you think of the children of Israel, you think of two main events. They think of the Exodus, with Charlton Heston, I mean Moses, leading the people out of Egypt, you know, and then they end up in the wilderness. But that one's pretty clear. We understand that, and let my people go, and they do that. But the exile is a little bit fuzzier for us. And part of the reason is Nebuchadnezzar invaded three times before that final time when so many were taken captive and taken back. You see it reflected later in that psalm in verse 4. It says, "How can we sing the songs of the Lord in a strange land?" Have you ever been in a strange land? Have you ever gone through a season in your life where everything just feels like the picture frame you had on the wall and what you expected in life has just been shattered and broken, and you can't find your place in the photo anymore? It just doesn't seem to make sense. That's where the people were. Someone wrote not too long ago that the past is another country because they do things differently there. That the past can never be recreated now. When you think about the way things used to be, that's a memory, but it is the past, and we do things differently now here in the future. And so the people express this harsh language, and the psalmist records these laments. The the pain of the people, the rage of the people, the fierce anguish that they were going through, that their world was upside down, and they expressed thoughts of vengeance, and even violence would rise in their minds to think about all they had lost. But to push back against the Babylonians had failed, and it didn't work. And so their emotions probably would have felt like those slaves that were snatched from their homeland and their continent in Africa and thrown in the bottom of ships and brought across the ocean here, that they became a landless people, no connection, having to start over. And the Israelites watched the violent destruction of their homes. So we now enter into the mindset of the prophet Jeremiah as he's talking to the people, but his take on things was different than all the other prophets. And he paid a price for it. He was trying to prepare the Israelites before, during, and after their captivity, or before and during their captivity, that all they knew they would lose, that their past was going to be destroyed and what they had become comfortable with. And I think today's message for you is, I want to give you three things to remember when your world is upside down. Three things to remember when your world is upside down. And I think it'll help you. And we'll do that, but first I want to describe Jeremiah's sermon to you. Jeremiah's sermon in chapter 7, we see his sermon and he's in major conflict with all the other preachers and prophets of his day, all the temple prophets. In fact, it was considered treasonous to suggest that God wasn't going to come through for the nation of Israel, that God wasn't going to save the temple, because they said God promised us that we would have a temple, that God promised David and Solomon, and we're standing on that. And so they saw Jeremiah as a liberal, that he was not defending the motherland, and they saw him as this rambling prophet who was crazy and weird. While all the other temple prophets said that God would not allow something bad to happen to his people. And so the dominant idea that claimed that Jerusalem was untouchable, that God had founded this nation and they did not have to go through bad times. So Jeremiah just attacks it head on. He called it organized hypocrisy, to paraphrase. And he says that God was fighting for the attention and the hearts of his people, that God was okay with them losing their land because he had lost their attention, that their land is not an unconditional gift. And, you know, when our family was happy, when we were in a good place, when things were going well for us, I just assumed that this is how life would go, and Whitney will have kids, and they will sit at our Thanksgiving table, and we will watch her raise her children, because that's all she ever wanted to do, was have babies and lead worship. And all of that seemed right and appropriate, and how could God not come through for such a saint like this? But it was not to be, and for God's people, the same thing happened. And Jeremiah told them, do not trust or stake your life on what the false prophets and these prophetic words are saying. That you can't stake your life on that. And maybe somebody's given you a prophetic word that you're never going to see trouble, or you're never going to, but you've got to be careful when you get those words. And the temple and the prophets and the royal liturgy were exposed by Jeremiah as a form of social control and manipulation. And Jeremiah says they won't be able to keep these promises to you. Of course, they threw Jeremiah in a pit. You remember, they dug a pit and threw him down a well. They get your message out of our ears. We don't want to hear it, even though it was the truth. Because the Bible says that even in the last days, people want to hear what they want to hear. And so for them, good preaching is stuff they already believe. Their worldview coming through the mouth of somebody up front with some Bible verses attached to it somehow makes it feel right. But God doesn't bow himself to the plans of man. And the temple, rather than being a place of transcendence here, Jeremiah exposes as a place of social and political manipulation by those that were in charge of the microphone. And so Jeremiah delegitimizes this idea that the absoluteness and the power of God is going to rescue them from exile. It's quite the opposite. The truth is, all of us are exiles. All of us are landless. All of us don't fit. And we are reminded with it every day because there's an empty seat at our table. And all of us are exiles from even the world that God envisioned for us. God envisioned a world where we would work together and be together, that we would be this human family to do good and to clothe those that didn't have that, and to give water and bread and so forth. And so the prophet then begins to encourage the people in Jeremiah's message. He says, look, let go of your despair and your anger and submit to a word of hope from God, to let go of that. And so if you are in the midst of something horrible or awful right now, just let go of being fixated on that and put your hope that God sees what's going on, God sees your heart, that God is with you, and that God will somehow bring you through that situation. That God never abandons, the prophet reminded them, his true people. That God doesn't abandon his true people. And in fact, God is involved in the coming and the going. God led the people in, and David took this town that was named Jebus, and ultimately it becomes the city of David named Jerusalem, the city of David, but then they lost it. And it would not seem, how in the world could that be a part of God's plan? And sometimes when we lose things, we don't understand how that could even work into God's plan. And so my text today comes from Jeremiah chapter 29. It starts in verse 1. Jeremiah wrote a letter from Jerusalem to the elders, priests, prophets, and all the people who had been exiled to Babylon by King Nebuchadnezzar. And then the narrator says this in verse 2. This was after King Jehoiakim, the queen mother, the court officials, the other officials of Judah, and all the craftsmen and artisans had been deported from Jerusalem. In other words, the narrator is saying Jeremiah was right. Or he was saying, told you so, is what he's saying. So verse 3 picks up, he says, this is what Jeremiah's letter said. This is what the word of the Lord of heaven's armies, so these are Jeremiah's words. This is what the Lord of the heaven's armies, wait a minute, I thought we just lost. How does heaven's armies lose? How does God not heal that loved one that you expected? How does not God not come through and save your business the way you expected him to come through and save your business? Jeremiah declares, he is the Lord of heaven's armies, the God of Israel. And this phrase, this one sentence, it's like one of those lines that a writer writes that you never forget. It was the best of times. It was the worst of times. Here it is. It says, this is what the Lord of heaven's armies, the God of Israel, says to all the captives he exiled to Babylon from Jerusalem. And here's what God says. Now, this is not what the other prophets are saying now, as we'll see in a second. But this is what Jeremiah says the Lord is saying. Build homes and plan to stay. What? That doesn't sound like a word from the Lord, does it? Build homes and plan to stay. Plant gardens and eat the food they produce. Marry and have children. Then find spouses for them so that you may have many grandchildren. Multiply. Do not dwindle away. And work for the peace and prosperity of the city where I sent you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, for its welfare will determine your... Wait a minute. So God is saying to the Israelites, through this reluctant prophet in some ways, who's being hammered by the stuff he's been saying, he's saying, God says, it's going to be 7 decades in this place. Sit down, build, have your babies, plant food, and work for the good of Nebuchadnezzar. Work for the benefit of the city. Verse 8, this is what the Lord of the heaven's armies, he says, the God of Israel says, do not let your prophets and fortune tellers who are with you in the land of Babylon trick you. Now the danger, the church is in huge danger now. You can all see it, I'm sure you can. The church is in huge danger that she stay in alignment with her King Jesus, that she stay in alignment with what Jesus wants. And here, I believe, is an important scripture for us. Do not let your prophets and fortune tellers who are in the land of Babylon trick you. Do not listen to their dreams, because they are telling you lies in my name. I have not sent them, says the Lord. And so as I thought about this, I thought, you know what? They're really, he's giving tips to the people on how to live in a landless place. He's giving tips to a family that's lost a loved one of how to survive that loss and just get through it and move on. He says, don't give up on the future. You're going to go on living as a landless people, but seek the good of the city. He says, you have lost your home, but keep your hope. He says, do good and try to benefit others and to notice and take up the cause and identify with the least of these. These shifts are pretty dramatic. The shifts for the Israelites, I try to put myself in their skin, and this time they've lost the temple now. It's gone. What they knew was gone. Everything was gone. Everything seemed strange. And he tells them, Jeremiah says to them, there is change in the patterns and policies in the social fabric of how you do life. There's change to that. So it's more than simply accommodating the Babylonians. This text of Jeremiah urges us to come to terms with empire, with governmental power for their Jewish well-being, that the deported Jews, the people that are now living in a landless place, must come to terms with this. And there's also then secondly, change in political governance, that the conflict, you wouldn't know this unless you're really a big time student of the word, but just trust me when I reference this without trying to take you here. It's from Jeremiah chapter 38, but Jeremiah and Hananiah are in disagreement, conflict. They've lost the temple, and many of them are in captivity now in Babylon. But there's argument in these two prophets, Jeremiah and Hananiah, about what they are supposed to do. Hananiah is wanting them to come up with subversive strategies of resistance to bring down Nebuchadnezzar. But Jeremiah says, don't do that. Cooperate with the ruling or dominant group. And there was argument, this conflict. Let me read it to one verse to you, verse 17 from Jeremiah 38. He says, if you will only surrender to the officials of the king of Babylon, then your lives will be spared. Isn't that amazing? Jeremiah 29, he tells them to abandon the strategy of force and seek the good of the city. Abandon that strategy and seek the good of the city. And they're thinking, I want to break off the yoke of Babylon and destroy that evil king that took down what we thought and busted up our picture frame. And Jeremiah says, don't do that. And third, and I know it's awkward, but third, he says, Jeremiah says, you have to find new expressions for your old historic faith in this landless place for the people of God with no temple. You have to find new expressions. And so here it is in chapter 42, verse 11 and 12. Just giving you his context. There's so much here, but I'm just giving you a highlight. I'm sure you're catching it, especially if you're in turmoil and have really gone through something heavy. He says, Jeremiah says, don't be afraid of the king of Babylon as you have been. Do not be afraid of him, says the Lord, for I am with you to save you and to rescue from his hand. I will grant you mercy, and he will have mercy on you and restore you to your native soil. So 7 decades later, God would bring the people to come back. They would rebuild the walls, as you remember, and rebuild the temple. But here, it's amazing that Jeremiah tells them to expect mercy from this king that had actually stolen them away from their homeland. And so that's the message. And here are those three things that I promised to tell you about. The first thing that you need to remember to get through this heavy, heavy time and season is, and the band are coming back. The first is, this place was never intended as your eternal home anyway. This place, this landless place, this place where I had the picture framed around my sweet little family, this place that it, for me, for us, doesn't exist anymore, this wasn't intended to be our home anyway, for we will be with her forever and ever in our forever permanent home. And so we trade neverness for foreverness. And so while it will never be the same again for us here in this earth, there is a foreverness that we long for. Birthdays are not happy for us anymore. There's no sense. I mean, you can send me a note about it, but I'm just telling you. Because our lives, we were centered as a family. We were tight. So birthdays, we get through birthdays. We tolerate birthdays. We tolerate Mother's Day. We tolerate Father's Day. I have the last Father's Day card that Whitney wrote me. We get through all of those things, but I will tell you that every day will be Mother's Day and Father's Day when we are reunited with her on the next side. And whatever you are going through, whatever suffering you're in right now, look, you have to somehow suck it up and try to create a new life in this moment and to live and do what you're supposed to do and seek the blessing of those around you until the hope of Israel, until the hope of your heart is fully restored. And there will come a day. You were not intended to live in this place for others. Secondly, we are ambassadors in a culture that doesn't serve our King. We're ambassadors in a culture that doesn't serve our King. We are surrounded by millions and millions of people that you know, I mean, I have to kind of edit myself as I go, but there's a lot of animosity toward Christians and toward the church. And some of it we've earned recently, but some of it is just there because the anti-Jesusness that is planted in this culture, it's never going to change. You're never going to fix the culture to make it be all that you want it to be. But you need to remember, regardless of that, we are ambassadors representing a King from a different location. This is not our homeland. This is not my homeland. So I live here, but if I were born in southern Antarctica, I would still feel the same way right now that we are passing through this place. We are passing through this place. And last, do you remember this? That our King doesn't allow us the luxury to withdraw and create our own separate existence away from the culture. Our King says, you don't put the light under a bushel. You don't hide it. What does the King say? That you are to be a bright light for the city. You are to be the salt of the earth. So you don't have the luxury to pull back from the pluralism and the liberalism and the whatever-ism of your day. You have to reflect Jesus, the ambassador of the King, and his banner over us is one of love. It's the banner over us. That's why when you do good to your neighbor, he says, now that looks like me. I can bless that. That looks like me. I'm engaged in that. So rather than our purpose to just try to grow old and not let anything bad happen to us or our kids and try to hold on to everything, maybe we understand that our purpose is to live through the holy hell that breaks out in our lives in one way or another and still reflect the image and the goodness of our King. For one day we will see him face to face and we will see the host of witnesses. Can you name one person in the Bible who got more than three sentences that didn't go through hell? You can't do that. Those only exist on Christian television. It does not exist in the Bible. It does not exist in God's word. You will go through hell on this earth. You will go through difficult times, but be of good cheer because we are under the banner of the one who has overcome the world, overcome sin, overcome death and the grave, and we will be with him forever and forever and forever. And therefore, then we can say, it is well with our soul. It is well, it is okay that we're going through this. Stand to your feet as we have this closing song. Sing along.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrow
God, we thank you for the invitation for it to be well with our souls. And we receive that invitation today. And I pray that as we go from this place, for all the situations that shouldn't be well with our soul, that we would hear the echo of this song in our heart and we would be able to look up and set our focus and attention on something more than the circumstances in front of us. We thank you that you are the God who never leaves, the God who always provides. And even though we face hardship and trials, you are still good. So I pray a blessing on every person, a blessing. I bless you in your coming and your going. And I pray blessing on your families with the promise of God's presence that is near you. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.